I'm Michelle Long. Same in Manila at 10 in Tokyo and 9 p.m. in New York. The headlines. Asian markets heading lower as declines in tech megacaps and simmering tensions in the Middle East dragged investor sentiment. The PSE index still in the red, kicking off from 65.62. Double Dragon's net income grew 23% to nearly 16 billion pesos last year. It's expecting a stronger balance sheet this year following the NASDAQ listing of its subsidiary, Hotel 101 Global. Ayala Group's listed energy platform, ASEN, signs a $150 million green term loan facility with a Singapore branch of Sumitomo Mitsui Banking Corporation. And later, we discuss how geopolitical tensions affect the global business climate with American Chamber of Commerce of the Philippines. We meet the very first female president of AmCham, Sarah Murphy. Plus, we talk about the transition to a cleaner energy future with Prime Infrastructure President Guillaume Lucci. We begin with a look at morning trade in Asia. They are heading lower Tuesday following Wall Street's tech slump. Benchmark markets in Japan, Hong Kong, and Australia opening down, as you can see, with the Nikkei 225 leading losses there, down by 1.6%. China, which opens in about 25 minutes, also signaling its caution towards monetary easing as currency depreciation pressures mount by withdrawing cash from the banking system for a second consecutive month. Chinese authorities have been struggling to manage economic risks and deal with policy divergence from Washington. Now, on tap for release today is China's GDP print, retail sales, and industrial production numbers. The Japanese yen also very much in the spotlight as it remains under pressure, having weakened 0.75% overnight against the greenback, boosting speculation once again that authorities may finally intervene. Meanwhile, we're also waiting for the IMF to publish its latest World Economic Outlook report. Now, stateside, U.S. futures may see modest gains. As you can see, futures are slightly higher by less than a 0.1% each. The Dow could see a rebound after falling for a sixth straight day yesterday. Now, over on Wall Street, tech megacaps dragged down stocks on Monday as bond yields jumped after a hotter-than-expected retail sales number spurred bets the Federal Reserve will be in no rush to cut interest rates. Simmering tensions in the Middle East also dampening investor sentiment, with a VIX, that's Wall Street's favorite fear gauge, hitting levels last seen in 2023. In the volatile session, if you look at the board, the S&P 500 fell about 1.2%, breaking below 5,100, its lowest in almost 2 months. The Dow Jones also losing over 0.75%, while the tech-heavy NASDAQ tumbled 1.8% as rate-sensitive tech megacaps dropped, led by Microsoft, Apple, and NVIDIA.
I felt like the market moved up strongly because I think there was this a relief that there didn't look like there would be a strong retaliation by Israel with everything that went on this weekend. But then the retail sales number was announced, and that came in hotter than expected. So when you couple the retail sales number today with the CPI print of last week, that's a pretty strong cocktail of hot economic data.
Now, in highlights from corporate America, two of Tesla's top executives have left the firm amid the carmaker's largest ever round of job cuts. More on that later in the show. CVC Capital Partners also reviving plans for an IPO in Amsterdam. Plus, Deutsche Lufthansa cutting its annual profit outlook as the German airline group absorbs the financial hit from prolonged strikes in recent months. Back here at home, here's a look at the local corporate headlines we're monitoring this morning. Double Dragon, which just celebrated its 10th year listing anniversary, saw a rosy 2023 with its net income jumping over 23% to nearly 16 billion pesos. Its total assets and equity also up around 16% year on year, with its net debt to equity ratio one of the lowest among Philippine listed companies. The firm expects stronger balance sheet this year after the merger of its subsidiary, Hotel 101 Global, with a U.S.-based JV SPAC, is completed, paving the way for its NASDAQ listing. Once completed, Hotel 101 will have an equity value of 130 billion pesos. Still on earnings, Apex Mining's net income up 6% to 3.5 billion pesos last year as revenue jumped 18% to 12.1 billion. Now, this was primarily driven by the high realized metal prices, with gold averaging over $1,962 per ounce and silver at $2,351. Century Properties Group capping its 2023 operations with a strong performance as well, reporting consolidated net income after tax of 1.86 billion pesos. That's 32% higher than in 2022. Revenue also growing 14% to 12.7 billion, driven by the sustained stronger contribution of its first home residential development platform. And Ayala Group's listed energy platform, ASEN, through its subsidiary ASEN Renewables International, signs a $150 million green term loan facility with Sumitomo Mitsui Banking Corporation, the Singapore branch. The green term loan, with a tenure of 5 years, aims to advance its strategic expansion into several key international markets, including Australia. Now, this marks the first partnership between ASEN and the financial institution, as ASEN aims to achieve 20 gigawatts of renewables by the year 2030. And going back to the earnings stream, Alliance Global Group, the holding company of tycoon Dr. Andrew Tan, posts a record-breaking 30 billion pesos in net income for 2023. That is up 20% year-on-year, despite higher inflation that pushed costs up across the board. Net income attributable to parent also up 21% to 19.6 billion, as consolidated revenues grew 15% to 211 billion pesos. Now, for those who missed it, a recap from yesterday's corporate earnings reports. Coconut product manufacturer Accelum Resources, which recently just secured a multi-billion peso investment from MVP, reported a core net loss of 158 million pesos last year, sales only hitting 5.7 billion. Now, that was attributed to the weaker than normal performance to the pandemic-induced shipping crisis and slower demand across key markets. Meanwhile, it's also setting aside up to 400 million pesos for CapEx this year. And the net income of Philippine fast casual restaurant Shakey's Pizza Ventures for 2023 hit over 1 billion pesos. It's 1.08. It breached the 1 billion mark. That's from 874 million it posted in 2022. Shakey says, while it booked double-digit growth across its portfolio last year, the persistent inflationary pressure continued to dampen consumer sentiment, leading to a softer growth performance during the second half of the year. Nonetheless, Shakey's delivered record-high fourth-quarter sales supported by festive comeback in December. Overseas efforts to end wars in the Middle East and Ukraine expected to dominate this week's meeting of the Group of Seven foreign ministers happening in Italy. The ministers from the U.S., Italy, Germany, Japan, France, Britain, and Canada are expected to present a united front in demanding a ceasefire in Gaza and reiterate the full backing for Ukraine in its two-year war against Russia. Israel has so far been resisting repeated calls to suspend their Gaza offensive, while over in Ukraine, the momentum seems to have shifted in Russia's favor, with the West seemingly unable to provide Kyiv with the weaponry it desperately needs.
Our international position is very clear. But if our position is strong, it's easier to talk with the others. We are united. This is crucial.
Meanwhile, the Israeli army vowing retaliation against Iran following its unprecedented attack over the weekend. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu summoned his war cabinet for the second time in less than 24 hours to decide how to react to Iran's first ever direct attack on Israel.
I want to thank all our international partners who stood up to Iran's aggression. Iran's attack has created new opportunities for cooperation in the Middle East. We are closely assessing the situation. We remain at our highest level of readiness. Iran will face the consequences for its actions. We will choose our response accordingly.
Thank you. The Middle East conflict threatening to cripple a fragile global economy. Financial markets are fluctuating while oil prices are heating up amid fears of a wider conflict in the volatile region. All these on top of uncertain rate environments and stickier than expected inflation narratives. To talk about how these tectonic shifts on the global stage are affecting investment decisions and ways to rebuild international business activities, we have with us Sarah Murphy, the first female president of the American Chamber of Commerce of the Philippines. Hi, Sarah. Welcome to Market Edge.
Thank you. Good morning, Mimi. It's nice to meet you. And I have so much respect for you in this program. So thank you for having me today.
No, thank you for having for joining us. I mean, we were supposed to invite you for Women's Month because you just made history as the first female president of the American Chamber of Commerce of the Philippines. So how has the work been so far? And what are your priorities?
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. So first, just so much appreciation for the opportunity to be the first female president of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce here in the Philippines. Big thank you to our members and my peers on the board for their trust in my abilities to lead the organization. You know, I'm not an expert in U.S. government or foreign affairs, and I won't pretend that I can speak fluently on what's going on in Washington or trade agreements, what have you. But as the leader of the chamber, I am a connector, and I can help amplify the voices of our members to make sure that we're able to grow and have a sustainable approach to doing business here in the Philippines. Mm-hmm. And that's very much aligned with my values, as well as the commitments of the chamber around advocacy, education and resources, collaboration and recognition.
You said that it's your job to amplify the voices of your members. What are they saying at this point? It's been a pretty interesting year. Pretty strong start to the year, and then things are it feels as if things are going to a pause right now. What are your members saying? What are you hearing from them? What are some of their top concerns?
Yeah, I think, you know, as you look around the world, like many countries are facing an aging workforce. I mean, many have upwards of 30% of their workforce aging out at like 55 years old or older. That's not an issue here. Where we believe there is an issue and an opportunity is with respect to upskilling our existing workforce for the future and then building sustainable hard and soft skills training into our education system. And so we must provision basic education, higher education, and vocational education to include relative skills, build training opportunities and exposure to the future. And so I think our role is to bring members together and collectively prioritize where we believe those investments are necessary and look across industries. I obviously sit in the BPO industry, and in my company, we work closely with the foundation on a contact readiness program. And while we will be changing hundreds of lives over the course of years, it's hundreds of lives over the course of years. But if we come together as a BPO industry and work to invest in the education system, we're talking about changing the lives of generations and future generations to come. Kind of goes back to the old adage, if you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go together. And that's absolutely the case here as we look across industries and investing in upskilling our existing workforce and investing in our youth.
Sarah, for those who are watching, as they may know you already, because you are the president of Capital One Philippines, you're leading how many? 4,000 Capital One associates in the country. And you're also, I know, taking initiatives to also expand in Southeast Asia your operations. So as a woman who's breaking these glass ceilings, what can women executives expect from the American Chamber of Commerce to help support other women who are also trying to climb up the corporate ladder?
Sure, absolutely. And I think, you know, it's human nature to look to others to kind of validate, narratives that we have about ourselves, both what's possible and maybe even where we're putting limitations on ourselves. So I hope that, you know, with my appointment, other female leaders can, you know, kind of really challenge themselves on what is possible. And then I think there's the power of storytelling. I always encourage all leaders, especially female leaders, to tell their stories because it's not often, you know, always what's visible. It's kind of your career progression, the obstacles you've faced, and what's not visible that really resonates with folks. And I know throughout my journey to this role, I've had moments where I've, you know, kind of put limitations on what position or opportunity or promotion may be possible because of who I was or who I wasn't. And that can be things like being a single parent or not having gone to business school or other things. And so I just think as women, we really need to pull together and continue to demonstrate and tell our stories to inspire others to achieve their full potential.
So is it safe to assume, Sarah, that under your leadership, I understand you're leading AmCham for 2 years?
That's correct, a 2-year appointment.
That education is going to take top priority.
It's education is absolutely one of our top priorities. Yes, Mimi, that's correct.
All right. And of course, you belong to the BPO sector, which you just mentioned earlier. What's the outlook for that industry? I mean, it has been one of the strong pillars of the economy. I remember during the pandemic years, it was holding up half the sky for the Philippine economy. How much more room for growth?
Yeah, I think there's continued room for growth, as you know, our BPAP team and Jack Madrid has said. You know, we're continuing to be bullish and have a pretty aggressive roadmap to 2028. You know, I think, you know, we just need to continue to be in tune with the changing needs of our workforce. Technology is bringing advancements. And so I think, you know, as we look at the future of work coming out of the pandemic, return to office mandates and such, I just, you know, I really encourage everyone to be open to listening and being open to trying new things and adjusting, getting it right and getting it wrong sometimes, and just continuing to kind of persevere. But I'm incredibly optimistic about the future of the BPO industry here. You know, we are the founding fathers and mothers of the BPO industry around the world. And I think folks continue to look for us for inspiration and best practices.
At Capital One, are you looking to grow the workforce this year? I mean, to back up this very bullish outlook on the industry?
Yeah, no plans to grow necessarily, but we continue to diversify and, you know, think about the work we do, whether that be voice or back office or even, you know, with an eye towards, you know, building the skills and the for technology and kind of where the future's headed.
All right. And final question, you are leading a 122-year-old organization. I sort of did the mental math. 122-year-old. If we speak again in 2 years' time, what do you think are we going to be talking about?
I hope we're talking about like more diversification as you think about industries that are growing here in the Philippines. Mm. Obviously, there's a lot of buzz right now about renewable energy, mining, manufacturing. And so I think while the BPO will be kind of the, you know, a strong, huge pillar for the economy, I think we'll see other pillars emerge and kind of grow over the course of the next couple of years. And I'm looking forward to celebrating that with the and with the country.
And you're confident that these new pillars will be supported by international activity still? I mean, the world is a crazy place today, so many things happening. Are you confident that the global economy will be chugging along by that time and will be supportive of these new pillars?
Yeah, I have a lot of confidence, and I think we have a lot of recent proof points, whether that be the trade mission or the recent trilateral discussions. I'm incredibly confident about the promise of the Philippines. And, you know, again, there's no crystal ball. If you had asked me, you know, 5 years ago what the future of work would look like in 2024, I would have gotten absolutely wrong. But based on what I know today, I am confident.
All right. And on that confident note, Sarah, thank you so much again for joining us and for sharing with us your perspective. It was a pleasure meeting you finally. We hope to have you again soon for more exciting projects with the American Chamber of Commerce.
Thanks so much, Mimi. Have a great day.
Have a great day. Now, the Philippine Central Bank, undaunted by the fact that out of the 6 digital banks operating in the country, only 2 are profitable at the moment. BSP Director Melchor Plabasan says this is not an isolated case. He says breaking even really takes time. And besides, only 20 out of the 453 digital banks globally are profitable anyway.
We do not consider it as a threat right now. It's it's not a concern right now because as I'm sure you are familiar with how the typical business operates. It's not only the business of banking. Normally, it really takes time before you become profitable, right? And normally, you would spend a lot in terms of operating expenses, in terms of establishing the core operations, contact center, hiring people, and while your products and services are picking up. So I think we don't see it as a concern right now.
Plabasan also bullish digital banks will soon gain more traction in the Philippines.
I think we have seen a lot of positive developments. You mentioned about 8.7 million accounts opened by digital banks. So that already represents about 7% of the Philippine banking system. Mm-hmm. So and it's steadily increasing based on the rate of increase right now. Mm-hmm. So I think Filipinos we have seen changing or shifting preference towards convenient, towards user-friendly, innovative products and services.
Now, only a few trooped to the offices of the Internal Revenue Bureau on Monday, the last day of the filing of annual income tax returns. Is this a good sign? Jacob Pascual gives us a recap of what happened during yesterday's filing.
Empty chairs greeted Herbert Buenconsejo, who filed annual income tax returns of his company on the last day of filing.
Kaya nga, nakakapagtaka ba't wala nga tao ngayon eh. Siguro mas inagahan nila magpa-receive kasi para ayaw na nilang ma-deadline.
He and a few other taxpayers who came to file their ITRs were also welcomed by a summer vacation-themed BIR office in Makati with free food. The agency says this is one way to entice the public to file their ITRs and pay taxes.
Hindi rin ganun kahaba ang pila, and that is good for us. And also, yung nakikita natin na feedback when we talk to the taxpayers, very positive ang kanilang feedback.
BIR Commissioner Romeo Lumagi says more people filed online, and he wants to expand the digitalization program of the Bureau because it not only cuts down the number of people lining up, but also encourages the public to pay taxes.
Marami talagang gustong magbayad ng tama, mag-report ng tamang taxes. Pero hindi nila ginagawa because it's very inconvenient. So kung online yan and they find it convenient, then gagawin nila yan kasi yung iba ayaw pumila, ayaw pumunta sa mga district offices.
With a high compliance rate of nearly 100%, Lumagi is confident of hitting the tax collection target of 3.055 trillion pesos for the year. That's despite not hitting last year's target of 2.67 trillion pesos.
We are also aggressive on our enforcement activities. Yung pong talagang harap-harapan talaga na talagang nag-violate at nag-evade ng tax. Katulad po ng against sigarilyo, paulit-ulit po tayo dyan. Yung illicit cigarettes, yung mga vape products.
He adds the Bureau is not yet revising its tax collection target even if the economic team has lowered its gross domestic product outlook for the year. A tax expert agrees that BIR can hit its target if it continues with its digitalization efforts. He also wants reforms for the tax industry to reach higher tax collection goals.
We really need to lift the bank secrecy law simply because the big-time tax evaders are still not caught. There are those who remain free and the BIR is having a hard time to really prosecute them. Hopefully, with the data sharing among government agencies, the BIR will also have an access who among them are really operating, who are dummy, who are laundering money. I guess all these informations are essential that BIR should have an access.
Lumagi reveals tax collection for the first 2 months of the year hit over 446 billion pesos, higher year on year and also higher than the target. He hopes that trend will continue until the end of the year. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Shifting gears now, 15 local government units were recognized at the inaugural Tourism Champions Challenge of the Department of Tourism. Out of 98 proposals, only 15 were handpicked, and topping the list are Ambagio Nueva Vizcaya, which is building its first paragliding airport terminal, Tubigon Bohol for the construction of infrastructure at the enchanted Ilihan Volcanic Plug, and Isabela City, Basilan for its Lampingan Jetty Port and Leisure Development Project. All three won first place and are getting 20 million pesos in grants each. Now, aside from the cash grant, the President's office will also provide an additional 5 million pesos to each of the 15 LGUs. The DOT is moving to improve the country's tourism sector after it contributed 6.2% to the GDP in 2022. From tourism to licenses, good news, the Land Transportation Office will resume today the nationwide distribution of plastic driver's license cards. This following the delivery of 1.6 million cards from Banner Plastics Inc. Now, that delivery was initially stalled after a losing bidder, All Cards, filed an injunction last year. Well, that was eventually lifted this March. Here's a quick look at the schedule for claiming those license cards. The The LTO says Banner Plastics is supposed to supply a total of 5.2 million plastic cards. It had delivered 2 million before the injunction and another 1.6 million after that was lifted in March. The remaining balance of 1.6 will be delivered by the first week of May. Now, this means all backlog of around 4.1 million cards will have been addressed by the end of June. It will also sign another contract with Banner Plastics for the delivery of a new batch of 6.5 million cards, which should cover requirements through January next year. The two-day transport strike against government's PUV modernization program continues. Some jeepney drivers spent the night on the streets of Welcome Rotonda in Quezon City to continue the protest today, Tuesday. Transport Group Manibela says about 8,000 drivers and operators participated on the first day of strike Monday, calling the move a success. Meanwhile, transport authorities are playing down the strike, saying it failed to paralyze public transportation. Some local government units in the metro are still deploying free rides to commuters that will be affected by the protest action. The consolidation of public transport operators and drivers into one entity will end on April 30 without any more extensions. Now here's a look at the other stories we're tracking in the newsroom today happening within the hour. The House Committee on Youth and Sports Development will tackle the use of athletic performance-enhancing drugs with the World Anti-Doping Agency. While at 10, we cover a forum about the effects of extreme heat. During that hour, Lichu Property Consultants will discuss its first quarter Philippine property report. Well, at 10:30 a.m., telco firm Eastern Communications will hold a discussion on its strategic CapEx as it celebrates its 145th year here in the Philippines. Well, at 11 a.m., the Philippine Foreign Affairs Department will hold a press conference with Singapore Minister of Foreign Affairs, Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan. And at 1 this afternoon, the Metro Pacific Tollways Corporation and Cavitex Infrastructure Corporation will hold a press conference about the operations of Cavitex. We have been reporting this since last week. Piazzi has actually demanded that the management of Cavitex be returned to Piazzi. Up next, John Mangan talks about financial survival in a market like this. Our PSE chat is next. Market Edge will be right back. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says the Philippine government won't hand over Rodrigo Duterte to the International Criminal Court. Philippine shares not spared from the bloodbath on Monday, down for an eighth straight session with a PSE index falling 1.4% to close at 65.62. Joining us this morning for more on the markets, it's John Mangan. John, hi. Good morning.
Good morning, Mimi.
How are you?
I'm doing great.
Doing great, even if the market's not doing so great. I mean, the PSEI, in the first 7 minutes of trade, already bleeding, down 0.8%. 52 points, we're at 65.10.
Okay. Next.
Look, you're not surprised.
I'm not surprised. I wouldn't be surprised if the market was going to go down another 400 or 500 points. All right, primarily because we have a trading gap way low that has not been filled yet. This move was to fill the trading gap at 66.20, which has already been filled. Trading gaps are always filled eventually. That's the way it works. Mm-hmm. Sure, it would be better if it was filled quickly, but that's just the way it works. And what are you going to do? I mean, how can I say this? What investors are dealing with is like trying to deal with a lying lover. All right. I mean, we've been promised this, we've been promised that, and it's all been lies. You look at, read my column today. I mean, 3 months ago, there was supposed to be 6 interest rate reductions in the U.S., equaling maybe as much as 150 basis points or more. And the latest thing is, well, maybe there'll be 2 reduction of interest rates. And if it's 38 basis points, that would be wonderful. We've been told here in the Philippines that the wealth fund would invest in the local market and yada, yada, yada. Nothing's been done. I mean, like I said, it's like dealing with a lying lover. You know, we've got lots of promises and none of them are going to come true.
Not yet. They will take time.
Yeah, but it's beyond this interest rate. Yeah, it's going to take time. It was supposed to be first quarter, then interest rates were going to come down. Mm. And now we're looking at an outlier situation that the U.S. inflation is so disastrous that there might even be an interest rate increase. I mean, with this election coming up, with this incredibly important election in the U.S. coming up, the Federal Reserve cannot lower interest rates because it will look totally like a political move. It's just not the interest rate. I mean, we've been told for 2 years that Putin was going to invade Berlin. We're constantly being told that the Chinese are just moments away from invading Taiwan. And the whole world is running on hyperbole right now.
So, John, you say, you know, this market's like dealing with a lying lover, a pathological liar that is a lover. In one of your recent articles on Business Mirror, you did talk about the battle for financial survival. Is this market moment, you know, a moment of battle for survival? I remember just a month, 2 months ago, it felt like a moment of abundance. You know, this market once priced for perfection, up 8% in the first 3 months of the year. Is it now priced for something else? How fragile is this market? Because right now we're at, what, 6,500? We're back to where we ended last year at 6,450.
Well, then take it as a buying opportunity, as a bargain. Look.
You're really a romantic.
No, because the reason the market was up was because we were being fed this information that the interest rates were going to go down.
Okay.
I mean, look, go back 2 years and listen to Janet Yellen, you know, whatever the hell her name is, telling us that inflation was transitory, it didn't matter, the inflation was a blip. And here we are 2 years later, and inflation is a critical, critical problem in the U.S. as well as in other places. Look, I don't want to criticize the press and media. But if you take a look at the last 2 years, it has been a constant stream of propaganda. You remember 2 years ago, Putin was ready to die? Well, suddenly he's not ready to die. He looks real healthy.
John.
And 2 years. Yeah, okay. Go ahead. Sorry.
Before we get lost in the Putin conversation. So you did say it's an opportunity to buy. I wonder, though, how gung-ho investors are. Will the dips be bought, you think, or... You know, when you've got geopolitics in the mix, does the market call become harder to make?
Well, first of all, I don't buy the dips, all right, because dip means the prices are going down. I only buy when prices are going up. It's just that simple. I mean, it's common sense to me, all right? Mm-hmm. You don't buy when prices are going down. You buy when prices are going up. Right now, prices are not going up, except... We don't buy the market. We buy individual issues. I mean, if you'd have bought Keppel last week, you'd be doing pretty well right now, wouldn't you? You would have effectively doubled your money. So the idea that we talk about the market going this way, yes. The rising tide floats all boats and the hurricane sinks all boats. But there's always opportunities. And if there isn't opportunities, the wonderful thing about the stock market is nobody puts a gun to your head and forces you to buy. All right. It's not like your electric bill. All right. They raise prices. You got to pay it. But in the stock market, you have the choice.
OK, so before we get to your stock pick, I wanted to get your visibility for the first quarter earnings season. We're going to start to get those numbers in the next couple of weeks. What are you realistically expecting to see?
I don't care. I don't even look at it. I don't look at earnings.
Really? Even when you do stock picking?
No, because earnings...
Rear view mirror.
earn, absolutely. Don't tell me what you did last year. Tell me what you're going to do for the future. That's the important thing. I mean, these companies coming, you had a couple of, well, let's see, you had a company that has come out with really good earnings, and the price was down 4% the day the earnings came out. All right. It is, and you look at Ayala Land. I mean, it's a disaster area. And
is it time to buy?
No, because the price is going down.
When do you expect the price to start going up?
When the price starts going up, that's the time to buy. I mean, to me, this is just common sense. Why would you buy something that the price is going down? Oh, yeah, wait. The only time you buy something when the price is going down is at Schumart's 3-day sale. Yes, that's when you buy when the prices are going down.
All right.
To me, it's just common sense.
All right.
That you don't buy when prices are going down. And prices are going down and 400 or 500 points lower.
Uh-huh.
I will not be surprised.
All right. John,
that's what it comes down to.
I think we're now ready for your blind item. This stock that you like, hopefully a stock that is about to see its price shoot up. So what do you have for us today?
Well, it's the same stock I gave you last month. I told you last month in the next 30 days it would either be 50% higher or 50% lower. Hey, I'm a lying lover. I made a promise that didn't happen. But nonetheless, in the last 2 months, this stock has been trading basically between $1.90 and $2.10. It's been a good trading stock. I am being told that the deal is still on and the price is going to appreciate it's going to go to the deal price in the next 2 weeks.
Huh.
And if it turns out I'm wrong, well, hey, I still love you.
But
my promises are not necessarily going to come true. But yeah, I'm still, this is one. Okay, why am I buying it? I'm buying it because the price is not going down. I'm buying it because it's been in a very contained range. And I'm buying it because I still think the deal is going to go through. So there you go.
All right. We're all waiting for that deal to happen. On that note, John, pleasure to speak with you. Thank you so much for the time.
Thank you, Mimi. My pleasure.
All right. From the lying lover, another update on the PSE index. The index is widening those losses. It's now down 0.9%, 58 points off. We're at 65.04. Wow, we're almost right back to where we ended last year at 64.50. Everybody's in the red, deeply in the red. All shares also down 0.75%. Services leading your losers, down by 1.7. Financials by 1.1. It's only one sub-index, one sector that's still holding on to the green, and that is the mining and oil, which is up by 0.6%. Not surprising considering how commodities have performed over the last few days because of geopolitical tensions. By the way, I'm seeing an important disclosure from Frutas Holdings here. I'm just going to open it because we are expecting an interesting acquisitions news from this group. We don't know what it is yet. Okay, it's not the M&A news, but it is reporting that Frutas Holdings has achieved all-time high revenue of 2.5 billion pesos for last year, 2023. That's up 37%. Pre-tax income also up 47%. Consolidated net income for 2023, 113 million, up 37%. So bringing more details, the breakdown on Frutas Holdings earnings report for 2023 all throughout the day. In the meantime, let's zip through the top headlines from major business papers from Business World. The Philippine Ports Authority has issued a notice to proceed to International Container Terminal Services, or ICTSI, for the rehabilitation and operation of the Visayas Container Terminal, or VCT, formerly known as the Iloilo Commercial Port Complex in Western Visayas. The Rizon-led port operator set to commence operations and the upgrade of the facility upon signing the notice to proceed. Then we go to Business Mirror. The Metropolitan Manila Development Authority, or MMDA, says it received a donation of 200,000 pesos from former Ilocos Sur Governor Luis Chavez Singson. Singson had promised to reward the agency's traffic enforcers for doing their duty after his convoy was flagged down for violating the EDSA bus lane policy last week. And from the Philippine Daily Inquirer, money sent home by Filipinos abroad posted higher. That's 3% growth in February as high inflation forced migrants to make bigger transfers to their families given rising prices. Cash remittances coursed through banks amounted to $2.7 billion for that month. Now, here is a quick look at the flash business headlines from overseas. India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi defended political funding through electoral bonds, which in February were scrapped by India's top court, which called it unconstitutional and said these protected the identity of donors to political parties, violated the right to information of citizens. Modi warns people will regret when there is honest reflection, as electoral bonds were meant to end unaccounted funds in elections, as it supposedly eliminated cash and corruption in poll funding. Former U.S. President Donald Trump's first criminal trial got off to a plodding start, with the proceedings stalling over disagreements about evidence and other last-minute arguments. In another setback, the judge ruled that jurors will be allowed to hear evidence about his alleged extramarital affair with former Playboy model Karen McDougal, saying it's a central element of the case. Also, we're moving on to the next story. Reuters reporting Tesla is laying off more than 10% of its global workforce. That's according to an internal memo it saw as it grapples with falling sales and intensifying price war for EVs. And we're also looking at Goldman Sachs, which reported first quarter profit beat Wall Street estimates as a recovery in underwriting and deal making boosted its investment banking unit, helping post the highest earnings per share since 2021. And the U.S. Department of Justice is preparing to file an antitrust lawsuit against Live Nation as soon as next month. That's according to the Wall Street Journal. The lawsuit would accuse Live Nation of leveraging its dominance in a way that undermined competition for ticketing live events. And finally, Coach Parent, Tapestry's $8.5 billion deal to buy Michael Kors owner Capri Holdings, finally gets regulatory clearance from the European Union and Japan. The merger, which would bring top luxury labels such as Tapestry's Kate Spade, Stuart Weitzman, and Capri's Jimmy Choo and Versace under one roof, is still waiting for the approval from the United States. Now, global investment in the low-carbon energy transition surged 17% in 2023, reaching $1.77 trillion, according to Bloomberg's Energy Transition Investment Trends 2024. Now, this number is a new record level of annual investment that demonstrates the resilience of the clean energy transition in a year of geopolitical turbulence, high interest rates, and cost inflation. What is the Philippine context here? Joining us this morning is Guillaume Lucci, President and CEO of Prime Infrastructure. I hope I said your name right, sir.
Very well, yes, All right. Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. So, of course, you're part of the Razon Group.
Yes, indeed.
Of course, Mr. Razon is into ports, is into gaming, and this is his infrastructure sustainability
arm.
What I wonder, when you have conversations in the boardroom with Mr. Razon, what's the marching order for you, for this company?
All right. Thank you for the question. Well, look, we set up Prime Infra in 2017. It's 7 years old. I had the good fortune of being employee number one of Prime Infra. And I think the marching order is very simple. We want to be an infrastructure player that addresses really critical needs in the market. Critical needs mean essentially infrastructure that serves a fundamental element of society. So power, waste management, water, right? And we want to do that in a, we use the term socially relevant fashion. What does that mean is that we want to do this in a way that responds to the needs of the population. That, of course, is an intrinsic part of the business model. It ensures that we have resilience in the business model and long-term continuity. Mm-hmm. So those are the marching orders.
So it's not just a nice-to-have arm. It's
no.
a need-to-have. You guys are a need-to-have. You're sort of like the arm that's looking at the future to make sure we have a sustainable planet that can sustain
Absolutely.
The population.
Absolutely. The business is built around that entire concept, right? And so managing these three pillars, energy, water and waste management, addresses the aspect of sustainability as well as addressing, of course, the needs of the population.
So we do know that you guys have a controlling stake in Manila Water.
Correct.
And nearly half of the Malimbay Gas Project.
Correct.
You recently exited the Terra Solar.
Correct.
And what sort of, how big of an investment is Prime Infra making in this great big push?
Well, so we're
making critical infrastructure.
Significant investments. So maybe I'll start with...
Is it at least at par with the 17% investment growth we saw last year?
Well, I think 17 is really an average. We're far above average. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So if we look at the type of investments we're making, look, let's start with Malampaya. Mm-hmm. Malampaya playing absolutely a critical role in ensuring, avoiding volatility, stability of gas prices, energy security. We have just contracted the drilling vessel that will come in next year and drill three new wells, two development wells, one exploratory well. Pagong Pagasa will be the exploratory well. We'll be spending over $750 to $800 million over the next couple of years to try to extend the life of Malampaya as far as we can, right? A very critical asset, of course, for the nation. On the energy side, we're investing heavily in energy storage. Last week, actually, we were granted by the Bureau of Investment.
The Green Lane.
The Green Lane, correct. And so those are significant investments. We're talking about 1,400 megawatts of storage, pump storage. We'll be spending about 250 billion pesos for that, over 140 billion pesos for another 600 megawatt pump storage. So these are significant investments we're making across the business. Without touching into the water side, we invested over 25 billion pesos in our bulk water project that is completed. The main dam is completed as of the end of March. It'll be ready, fully completed by the first quarter next year. And that will service the east zone of Metro Manila, supplying over 700 million liters per day of water. So there, massive investments across all three sectors, and I haven't even touched on the waste management one.
We'll get to the waste management. That's pretty exciting. I wonder, though, it's been 7 years of building critical infrastructure for Prime Infra. Many of these projects are big ticket, long gestation periods.
Correct.
When do you expect these projects to start churning in profit? Contributing to
excellent question. And the 7 years is when the company was set up. As you can imagine, these things are very long in the making, very long gestation period, as you rightly pointed out. So Wawa, which is our bulk water supply project, again, the main dam was completed at the end of March. We actually will be starting what we call the controlled impounding, filling up the reservoir in May. We will be generating cash at the end of 2025, which is when our offtake agreement starts. So we are actually finishing that project 6 to 12 months ahead of schedule.
Wow.
We're very proud of that. It's the first dam built in the country since 1967. So I think it's quite a milestone for the country in terms of water supply and scale of the infrastructure. Malampaya, the drilling program will start next year. Hopefully we'll have gas 2026, 2027, as soon as we possibly can, obviously. Then it will be generating cash at that point. On the waste side, we're already generating cash in Cebu, and we'll be building a new facility that will be inaugurated here in a couple of weeks in Pampanga to treat large-scale volume waste, 3,000 tons per day. So we're already fully operating, and as you know, we obviously have brownfield asset acquisitions like Manila Water that obviously already generate cash.
Well, let's go back to water. You've got Wawa, you've got Manila Water. Everyone watching us is probably wondering, are we supposed to be worried about water supply this summer?
Well, I don't think so.
Okay, that's very encouraging.
No, I don't think so. Look, at Manila Water, at least, we're well prepared.
Okay.
El Nino is, of course, was expected. The severity of El Nino is always difficult to assess. You know, right now, if I'm not mistaken, Angat Dam is somewhere around 194 elevation. 180 is critical. Normal is about over 210. We're already in April. Look, things are going okay. 50 CMS is still being released from Angat. We're augmenting that with all the other water sources that we have. Manila Water has done a tremendous job to build other water sources around Laguna de Bay and else. So, as far as Manila Water is concerned, no. Across the nation, there will obviously be pockets of challenges given the extent of the drought.
So from water, I want to go to waste.
Okay.
The waste to energy. This is pretty exciting. I was looking at the Commission and Audit report. They said that in 2000, the Philippines actually unloaded or discarded about 9.1 million metric tons of solid waste.
Yes.
That shot up to about 16.6 million metric tons in 2020, and were projected to unload 24.5 million metric tons of waste by 2045 as our populations grow and we continue to industrialize. And a lot of that waste can be turned into energy. Do we have the infrastructure?
Today we do not.
We do not.
That's the answer. And you know, to be clear, Mimi, we are not into waste to energy.
Okay.
For that matter, we're advocates of not doing waste to energy. The simple reason is that producing energy from waste is a very costly.
And it produces more waste.
It produces
along the
more
way,
waste.
That's what
it's a very costly energy that the population has to pay for. The countries that have done that very successfully typically are countries that have benefited from subsidies.
So what are you guys doing about waste?
So what we're doing is, thanks for asking, we're actually collecting this waste, treating it, segregating it, recycling all that can be recycled. And so that's the first phase. Today in Cebu, we handle over 60% of the waste. It's fully automated, so we actually bundle the waste into little bags, if you wish. And these very large-scale industrial bundles are kept for further processing. Eventually, we will take the organics and transform that into either renewable natural gas or methanol. Mm-hmm. Methanol to be used actually to power ships. The idea really is to really industrialize the waste business in the country at high scale. And the purpose of that industrialization process is hopefully as we go through treating the waste, we will actually avoid putting any waste into what people call today landfills. That's why our facilities are material recovery facilities. Over the medium term, for every ton of waste that will come in, we expect no more than 10 to 20% to be discarded. Everything else will be transformed into, call it a value-added product, right? Whether it is fuel or metal recycling and so on and so forth.
All right, and would you say that the waste part is expected to play a bigger role? I mean, when you make a pie chart of your operations, how big is the waste part?
Well, today it's small. Today, the two large, really, elements are water and actually gas.
And natural.
Our pump storages are not online yet. They will be online by 2029, 2030. So waste today is a small portion. Of course, by the time we start converting that waste into fuel, then we'll take on a bigger proportion. Ha. Time will tell.
And solar. Everyone's wondering why the love affair with SPNEC was so short-lived. they bought you out for $6 billion last year. What was the rationale? Are you done with solar power?
No, so we're just finishing now a 128 megawatt solar farm that we're building.
On your own?
On our own. It's completed now. We own 100% of that. It's between province of Patangas and province of Cavite. Mm-hmm. So that's going well. We'll be connected in the next couple of weeks.
Okay.
The love affair with SPNEC is nothing to be debated. We collectively, with the shareholders, thought it was best that we parted ways and left the company in good hands to take the business forward. And that's what we've done. We wish them great success. We really hope that project will come to life.
What happens to your RE dreams then? So you're going to do it alone. So you've got a solar one.
Yeah, and then we have our pump storages.
And then the pump storages.
Yes.
All right. And of course, before we end, everyone is excited for the IPO of Prime Infrastructure. You guys are the favorites, the darling IPO contestants or candidates for this year. There was Prime Infra, there's Mint and SM Prime REITs. All of you guys seem to be pushing back the date.
Yes.
Is there a new timeline for this?
Well, no, there's no new timeline. There's not even certainty of an IPO. There are many different ways to raise capital, so we're evaluating all the available options. We live in a very uncertain world, right? As you are announcing through these headlines, right? Look at what's happened to fuel prices with the Russian-Ukraine war. Look at what's happening now in Iran, between Iran and Israel. That combined with a very unpredictable rate market, it's very difficult to decide what the best path forward is to raise capital. So the public markets are not the only solution to that. We're evaluating all available options and we'll make the right decisions in due time.
But where you stand today, you think that an IPO is not likely anymore? At least in the next 2 years?
Probably unlikely in the medium term, yes.
In the medium term.
Yes.
All right. But we'll see. More exciting news ahead.
Fantastic.
From Prime Infrastructure. Cheers to the next 7 years.
Thank you,
employee number one. We're looking, how big is the workforce today?
Well, across the entire portfolio, well over 3,000 employees.
Ah, so. All right. Please do visit us again if you have
will.
More exciting
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure being here.
All right.
Thanks.
Congratulations on 7 years.
Thanks.
Now, before we go, for those who tried to guess the blind item, this is the pick of John Mangan. This stock is, drumroll please, Cemex Holdings. Do let us if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. In the meantime, that's it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe and stay with ANC.